So let us be called to worship. God is our rock, our foundation. We are living stones used to build God's temple. Come and sit. There is room for all. Let us pray to the Lord. With all our hearts and with all our minds, let us pray to the Lord, saying, Lord, hear our prayer. For the peace of God found in the Christ that mends our souls, even when we believed them to be beyond repair, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayers. For the peace of the world, for the welfare of the church, and for the unity of all peoples, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayers. For the elected leaders of our nation, for the elected leaders of all nations, and for all in authority, may they know your wisdom and may they be humbled before you as they hear the wisdom of their advisors. Today, we especially lift Dr. Fauci and his team as they strive to provide calm, measured information for our country seeking quick answers to this complicated and evolving situation. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayers. For our cities and their leaders as they work around the clock to address the acute needs that continue to rise during this pandemic, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayers. For an abundance of the fruits of the earth, for the wisdom and the will to be good stewards of this gift, so that all may have enough, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayers. For the sick and the suffering, for those doctors, scientists, nurses, therapists, and all caregivers who seek to find cures for illnesses and offer comfort to the sick, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayers. For the poor and the oppressed, for the unemployed, the marginally employed, for those without homes, for prisoners, for migrants and captives, and for all who remember and care for them, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayers. For deliverance from all danger, violence, and oppression and degradation, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayers. We lift with thanksgiving those for whom suffering is no more, who have gone before us, who rest in your everlasting love. May their families find comfort in your promises of peace. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayers. For forgiveness for what we have done and what we have left undone, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayers. Comforter, protector, creator, we come to you in this strange, confusing, and tiring time like chicks seeking refuge and protection under their mother's wing. We pray that you would guard and guide us with the same fierce confidence of a mother hen. We come today remembering mothers. We remember mothers who loved us and who have died, some after long and fruitful lives, and some too soon to ever know their children. We lift them with thanksgiving. We remember the mothers who did not know how to love, to care, and who caused pain and suffering to their children. We pray for their forgiveness, and for their offspring we pray healing and grace. We remember the mothering hopes of those who so long to be mothers, but for whom this was not a possibility. We pray that you may fill that void with what you know to be helpful for each woman. We remember mothers whose work takes them away from their children to serve in hospitals, in battle, in care facilities, in journalism, in housekeeping, in all the ways that women work to serve the greater good. We pray that their work be blessed, their children well cared for, and that they may soon be reunited with their loved ones. We remember mothers in refugee camps and mothers who walked across nations fleeing oppression, seeking better lives for their children in tow. We pray they are greeted with compassion. We pray for mothers without homes, mothers without jobs, mothers in prison. May we learn to be loving people of God who will find ways to care for them and their children. Divine author of life, you called us into being. We pray that we may live into lives that you would have wished for us. We pray that our thoughts not be clouded with fear, envy, or pride, and that we be thoughtful, hardworking, and forgiving. Your followers named us precious stones. May we be worthy of such a name. We come to you humbly as we pray the prayer your Son taught us, saying, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Today's lesson comes from 1 Peter 2:2-10. Like newborn infants long for the pure spiritual milk, Like newborn infants long for the pure spiritual milk, so that by it you may grow into salvation. If indeed you have tasted the Lord is good, come to him, a living stone, though rejected by mortals, yet chosen and precious in God's sight. And like living stones, let yourselves be built into a spiritual house, to be a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. For it stands in Scripture, See, I am laying in Zion a stone, a cornerstone, chosen and precious, and whoever believes in him will not be put to shame. To you then who believe, he is precious. But for those who do not believe, the stone that builders rejected has become the very head of the corner, and a stone that makes them stumble, and a rock that makes them fall. They stumble because they disobey the word, as they were destined to do. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own people, in order that you may proclaim the mighty acts of him who called you out of darkness into this marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. So 1st and 2nd Peter, the books of 1st and 2nd Peter, were letters that were written from Rome, which he calls Babylon, and sent to the various churches that were forming in Asia Minor, or modern day Turkey. And these were relatively small groups of new Gentile believers. Peter knew they were being persecuted because they were living in different ways from the people around them. And he wanted not just to teach them theology, but also to encourage them in their faith. And he did this by likening their experiences to the journeys of the Israelites, those who had left Egypt and all they knew behind them to become the people of God. And so he made them understand that they were new followers of this risen Christ, and they too were leaving behind their old ways. But they, like the children of Israel, through this journey, they were the people of the new covenant, and they too had become now the people of God. Now, in scripture that's not included in the reading today, Peter begins his letter by describing the actions of a Christian. A Christian is to be full of hope, to strive to be holy, to live with fear or reverence of God, and to love one another deeply, and to desire what will bring growth to one another and to the community. Then, after describing the actions of a Christian, he goes on to describe who Christians are. Now, these fledgling groups of Christians he called precious stones. When these stones gathered, they formed the temples of God. They are valued. They are chosen. They are the body. Now, these fledgling Christians lived in areas where they were familiar with the great temples in their area to the Roman gods. Now, Peter was encouraging them, telling them that even though they met in their simple houses, not these big, beautiful temples, that they themselves formed precious temples. I also imagine that Peter, in his own mind's eye, had an image of the ravaged temple in Jerusalem, which just a few years from the time that this book was written had been destroyed by Roman armies. Now remember that although Peter was welcoming the Gentiles into this new movement, he remained a Jewish follower of Christ. And so the Romans had pummeled his temple, and he saw those shattered walls, not as just gravel in Jerusalem. Rather, those broken columns and those walls were transformed into the precious stones of new believers in new lands. In many ways, the beginning of this letter is about character. Character is an old-fashioned concept and something we don't talk about much anymore, but it's not something that's gone away. And one can be uneducated, poor, an outcast, and have a sterling character. One can have all the money that one could ever need, have gone to the best schools, be welcomed by royalty, and be a scoundrel, a rogue, a selfish person of ruptured character. One can be pleasant and tidy, but have no depth of character to understand the plight of others. In 1957, Melba Beals was one of a group of African-American students that were later called the Little Rock Nine. These students integrated Little Rock, Arkansas's Central High School. When these children showed up for school, they were met by a mob of thousands of angry white protesters. The violence that day became so extreme that they were removed from the school. The next day, President Eisenhower ordered the 1,200-man, 327th Airborne Battle Group of the U.S. Army's 101st Airborne Division to escort these nine students into school. They stayed there through Thanksgiving, but in Thanksgiving, when the 327th withdrew, the 153rd Infantry took up protection of the students in the school for the rest of that year. Melba Beals wrote in her diary at that time, "Integration is a much bigger word than what I thought it was." In 1995, she wrote a memoir titled Warriors Don't Cry. She wrote that she found the courage to continue going to that school amidst all of this military anger because her grandmother had told her, "We are God's ideas. Therefore, you must strive to be the best of what God made you." During these days, when we are forced to live our lives in different ways, facing unknown challenges ahead of us, we see examples of character popping out all around us. Some examples are sterling, and some certainly tarnished. If indeed we considered ourselves to be God's ideas made flesh, how would we behave? I think we would consider the health and safety of others, not just our own. That's why we wear masks. We put up with fogged glasses and a steamy face to keep what unbeknownst to us might be in our breath from harming someone else. That's why we take care of the business that is necessary, then go home so that others who must work can continue to do so for all of us. We do this because as Christians, we are to love one another deeply and do whatever is necessary for the growth of the individual and the group. I think we would continue to find ways to share with one another, to be prudent in our spending, and to understand that the economy is going to struggle. But we will live as people of hope, even if we find ourselves at times frightened or anxious. We live in hope because we are assured of God's grace and love, even as we walk through the dark and dangerous valleys of our lives. I think we would take this time of reckoning to raise our heads from our normal routines to really see and recognize the majesty of God. To know that God is God and we are not. I was taken aback by questions raised by a minister this past week during a Zoom meeting of which I was part. First, he asked the state's attorney general if he was required to follow occupancy or social distancing standards as he opens his church. No, he wasn't required by law, but it is recommended, But the AG was certain that the pastor would know what was best for his congregation. Then the pastor wanted to be assured that he would not be held responsible for anything that happens to those who attend, that his parishioners wouldn't be able to sue him if they got sick. I was busy writing in the chat session. Of course you're responsible for the safety and well-being of everyone who comes into your building. Not to try to do everything possible is absolutely unethical. You must find out what you need to do. Other questions followed that made it clear that many of these ministers follow a God that is confined to their preaching, to their presence, and their buildings. I do not know who their God is, but their God is too small. For I know the God we celebrate, we worship, we honor, is present wherever we are. The God we celebrate, we worship, we honor, is with us when you have a pastor and when you are in between pastors. The God we celebrate, we worship, we honor, would never expect that the first question out of our mouths is to seek assurance that we are not responsible for one another. If we are truly God's ideas, we must strive to be the best of what God has made us. For if we are living lives of Christian character, we will not be conformed to this world. Rather, through study and conversation and worship, our minds will constantly be renewed, and we will discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. I pray that we may be precious stones of hope, a people of character, the best of God's ideas. Amen. I invite you, if you have the elements at your home, that you would gather them and join together with us in communion. And if not, that you would share in the communion of spirit and know that God's grace and blessings rest with you today and always. That we gather together to break bread. For on the night that Jesus was betrayed, he gathered with his friends and he took bread, blessed it, and broke it, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which has been broken for you." Took the cup after dinner and blessed it, saying, "This is the cup of the new covenant which is poured out for you. As often as you are gathered together, may you eat this bread and drink this cup in remembrance of me." Let us pray. Holy, beloved Christ, we believe that your spirit is with us when we gather. We are thankful for the gift of communion that you began with your companions. We thank you for this reminder of your life and your sacrifice. Although we cannot be together in one place to share in the bread of life and the cup of the new covenant, we ask that you would bind our hearts in communion with you. May we never be separated from your love, made known in your beloved community. And it is in your name that we pray. Amen. And now let us affirm our faith. We believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and we accept him as our Lord and Savior. So go now to love and serve your Lord. Be the precious stones of God's holy temple.
Upper right corner.
May the wind be at your back. May the sun shine.
Amen. Happy Mother's Day.